question. This will repeat until when? The timer.
Yeah.
It will repeat until when?
This is going to stop now. Once this starts, we're live.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
I just texted Munto to join.
Mama, unmute.
Welcome. Lone, nou kontan akyeyi jodi a. We're very happy to welcome you to the celebration of the life of my joyous sister, Rejane Dominique Magloire, daughter of Marie-Christine Domerson and Jean-Gérard Magloire. Granddaughter of Julienne Dronette, Joseph Domerson, Mathilde Magloire, and we are so happy to not only present her to them, but to their parents, to their grandparents, to their great-grandparents. And we are so glad to know that she's welcome by all those who brought her onto this earth. And thank you so much for being with us.
Miss Sister Kim.
Welcome, everyone. I'm here in honor of my sister, Rejane Dominique Magloire, and will announce all of the siblings in the family. So first, Baina Bello, myself, Kim Magloire, then there was Rejane Magloire, and then May Magloire. And so we are pleased to welcome to celebrate her as sisters.
Sister Joelle, would you, you're muted.
Bonjour, family. Hello. I am one of Rejean's many, many cousins. I welcome you. We come together to recognize that Rejean is survived by two aunts, Tuck Colette Gay and Beneni Pap, the oldest living relatives as well. And there are 32 cousins. Merci en ville.
My name is Rejean Dominique Magloire. I come from Africa. I was born in Congo, but I was raised in New York City.
This is a period. Pass it on.
The short circus kids have 5 seconds to read the next word they see.
It is now 1975, and Rejean is now on a TV series called The Electric Company. She gets to work with all these cool actors and actresses. Some of them call the short circuits, which were the kids who performed. But in her case, she was able to be Morgan Freeman's daughter in a lot of the skits that they ended up working on. And
can you read it before they do?
Kids! Kids. Did you really expect us to mess that up?
I mean, it's the easiest word.
Cookie face?
Yeah?
This is a period.
Okay.
Pass it on.
All right. This is a period. Pass it on.
Thank you, I will.
This is a period.
This is an exclamation point. Pass it on!
Okay. This is an exclamation point. Pass it on!
Yes, Mama.
What's up, Doc? Don't go into shock. We're about to sock you with the knock.
Peanut when you eat it, or it's sure to make you choke.
No joke.
Okay, we need to unmute devices, please.
In the name of the Domerson, Magloire, Joseph family, Gronet family, we welcome you. And we are here to talk about Rejean. Kim?
Yes. Well, I'd like to share. I'd like to share with you many of things that were really special or unique about Rajan. And first, people may not have realized that she had scoliosis, which is a curvature of the spine. Now that impacts your ability to dance, to move, as you can imagine. And she had to wear a brace during her middle, you know, say 10, 11, 12, 13 years instead of having surgery. And so to see how amazing she was on stage, how her ability to just dance and she loved to dance and perform, it is quite a tribute that that did not come as easy to her as a young child. The other story I'd like to share is how she got on the electric company. My father had passed away and my mother was home for a year and happened to be watching a television show where there was a manager who was asking if you have a child that you would like to be evaluated or to come in to interview to bring them in. And of course, my mother brought her in, and within weeks she was going on auditions. And her third audition was for The Electric Company, which is a spinoff of Sesame Street. But the nice part of that story is originally Electric Company was looking for a Hispanic person to replace Irene Cara, who was a Cuban American. And so my mother actually taught her a song to sing in Spanish for the audition. And when they were down to two finalists, ironically, both of them were not Hispanic. And they asked them not just to sing in Spanish, but in English. And Rajan was the one that got the part. A last tie-in to that, to tell you how the world or how things work. When we were younger, my mother was combing our hair while she was watching one of her soap operas. And interestingly, Irene Cara was on the show singing on the soap opera. And Rajan, and I was in the room to hear it, looked at her and said, I could do that. Not knowing a few years later, she would be replacing Irene Cara on the Electric Company and they would call her Little Irene.
Mama, yeah, please unmute your device.
Sorry. Thank you. Thank you, Kim, for what you shared with us. And you can go on and tell us who's the next person.
My name is Robert Eldridge.
And I figured it was Robert something.
I play basketball at your house with your brothers and sisters in the backyard. Did you see my last basket?
No.
Man, you really missed something. Faked two guys with a dipsy do, then sunk it. It was really something. Where you going?
Nowhere.
You want to shoot some baskets?
No.
You want to go for a swim?
Nah.
Yes, Mom. Papa, Mama wants me to see how you was doing.
Oh, I'm doing just fine.
That's good.
Well, my honey, your mama and me had a talk. And this is for you.
I
just fine. Go show your mama.
Now, this scene was from a movie called Wilma, based on the famous Olympian runner, Wilma Rudolph. And that was in 1977. What was interesting about that is the mother in the movie was... hold on a second. Cicely Tyson, and she was able to, you know, they would look at people at different age groups. You know, they had her as a young child, they had her as a preteen, which Lejeune represented, and then they had her obviously as an adult. As a young child, they were looking to cast another person for that role, and they couldn't find someone who had a disability in the same way or who would perform with a disability. And in the end, we knew someone who had a similar disability, and we got her casted to play Wilma Rudolph as a young child. Now, for the older age group, the gentleman who played the boyfriend, as you saw in the scene, and later became her husband, was played by... Baena?
Mama, please unmute your device.
Yes.
Yes, I have so many names in my head. The name of the gentleman who played her husband as an adult. Kwasi?
Was it Denzel?
Denzel Washington, yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And the film took place in, the filming of the movie took place in Tennessee. And it probably took, we were probably there for a few weeks to film her section, and then obviously came back to New York.
Can you share with us how she prepared for the role? Do you remember?
I can. I mean, what was interesting is, first of all, she had to practice that Southern accent. And so it wasn't just memorizing words, but now memorizing a way of speaking. And then using a brace and limping in a certain way. And if you see what happens throughout the movie, I mean, she was pretty disabled as a child and was ridiculed for it. And then she had to show how she started playing basketball as a way of overcoming her disability. And so you get to see a nice progression of the evolution of Wilma and how Rejane had to really live or embody that whole experience.
It was natural to Reggie to be. She didn't play, but she was when she took a personality. She just be it.
Did she always have that attitude towards projects growing up?
I think she did, but she really honed it with, at a young age, being on the electric company. Because, you know, a lot of children that age, you know, she did many TV commercials, countless of them. But they're so short. So you get in, they tell you what they're looking for, you try out, and you hope that you're presenting the person that they want, and then it's over. But the nice part is when you have a chance to be on a series for a while, you get to really feel your character and then explore different ways of presenting that character. So she really evolved when she was, you know, in her ability. Another tidbit, because I would go on auditions as well with her, or not always in the same time, but we were sometimes sent for the same commercial. And the other girls, sometimes they would see her walk in the room and you could see the eyes roll, or here we go, or how is she gonna do it this time? Because she took it so seriously. So she would read whatever the script was, memorize it very quickly, and add her own spin to it. And she enjoyed it. Now, the average, at that time, the average person who was on auditions, you were lucky if you got 1 out of 13 calls. She easily probably was 1 out of 5.
Okay, now we're gonna go into a couple of photos, some family photos.
Okay.
Could you give us a little commentary on the most momentous photo on this slide that you saw?
I'm on. I guess the one of us as children for me is more interesting. Because you get to see, when you see the diva that she is today, it's still so nice to see the young child and the innocence as well.
And of course, the transformation.
Yeah, well, exactly.
The person went through all types of transformation.
I remember when braids, suddenly because of one movie, people started wearing braids. But she was wearing all different kind of hairstyles early. So whether it was the braids with the beads or different color hair or curly versus straight, she was always going and at one point she cut off her hair. She had very short hair, for example. And that was the style to have a product that made your hair kind of curly in the process. So she was very adventurous that way. And embraced it all and knew nothing was permanent. So it wasn't something where if she didn't like it or she knew she could change it.
Yes, Reggie is an avant-gardist.
And then the other pictures of her as, because people can't always imagine that, her as a mother. She was a young mom and still had a career. And the beauty shared that with her children. I can remember when her son Sasha was young and I came to visit and we were playing some music and she was encouraging Sasha, let's dance, but don't just dance. You got to dance all the way down to the floor and almost as if your butt touches the floor and dance all the way up. So it wasn't just playing around kind of thing, but the way she said it, it's like, if you're gonna dance, you gotta really dance. And so she shared that not only with her fans and lived it, but shared it with her children.
I hope Alex is with us.
Yes, I see Alex is here. Would someone introduce this handsome young brother?
This is my brother, Alex Magloire. Doctor, eldest in term from my father's side of the family, of the children, and a great artist as well. He's another multi-talented member of the family.
Alex, you're there?
Yes, I'm there. How you guys doing? Do you hear me now?
Yes, we're doing fine. We're happy to have you.
Oh, the pleasure's mine. Yes, sad to hear about what happened to Jeanne, but anyway, we'll celebrate her life. She's been a blessing to the family from both sides. We have kind of scattered around the world. We have families that are in Mexico, and they never got a chance to meet her, but we always would follow the or go on YouTube or on the internet to find out who she is. And my auntie, which is the last survivor of the Magloire family, she's living in Cuernavaca, Mexico. I've not told her that, but my sister went to spend some time with her, my sister Wanda. And I'd promised, I did a genealogy tree, and from both sides, on my great-grandmother's side, and also from my great-grandfather's side, on both sides. And I was able to gather that information from my grandmother, actually, who died and buried in Mexico, cemetery in Cuernavaca. We were close to each other because I did study medicine in Mexico, then came back to the States to finish my career in medicine. We go back 3-4 generations because we talk like lovers, you know, ask all kind of questions, the family. And fortunately, I took notes, and that would be a blessing to the generation that will follow. And I'm currently living in Mexico. I'm not Mexico, no. Currently living in California. And two children, two boys, they are grown and outside the house. And living with my wife, her name is Finita Magloire, and having a hell of a good time in California. I've spoken to Rajan a few times before passing. I was kind of sorry not to meet her in Belgium. We spent some time in Belgium 5 years ago. Tried to connect, but that didn't happen. We're in Brussels for about 10 days. But anyway, is it okay to share about the family tree now, or should I wait?
I think we'll wait. We'll come back to you for that.
Oh, sure, absolutely.
But I do want to underline to all the younger ones listening that Alex, our brother, said that he gathered the generational information from his grandmother. He didn't Google it. We have elders in the family. These are the people to whom we must ask the questions.
So you don't need to go to ancestry.com. You get it straight from the horse's mouth.
That's right. Is Aunt Colette online?
Before I say anything, I have Kwasi and Claudia. People are saying that they can't join. There's an issue, or they're being asked to pay to join. Can someone look into that, please?
To pay to join?
So I've been.
Okay, we'll look into that.
Okay. Or if they could be sent, Claudia, if they could be sent another link. So whatever email list you had, they're looking to get another link to see. They got the one that ends with creators that you sent me. But if there's any other, I don't know what other link you may have sent out with the email I sent you. So I don't know if is Tante Colette or Mantovani, are they online?
Yes, Mantovani is available. Are you available to speak, brother?
And also just to show their faces as well.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello, can you hear us?
Yes, we can. We can see you.
Okay. I'm going to try to sing the song.
Go ahead, Tante Colette.
Do you like it? You heard it before. Voy por el mundo sin rumbo fijo, no siento pena ni siento amor. Soy el fantasma de mi pasado, soy de las almas que olvidan Dios. Tuve un cariño que fue mi vida, fue mi locura, mi adoración. Soy el fantasma de mi pasado, soy de las almas que olvidan Dios. I miss you, Ishan, because I met you in Paris. We were together with your husband and the second child. He was so cute. He was very nice to me. So I don't know how I will resign. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you, Tante Colette. Oh, I applaud. This was beautiful. And it shows. Rejane didn't pick it up from anywhere. It's in the family. My mother sang, my mother recited poems, my Christine de Melson. And we see Tante Colette, who is the second eldest in the family. She too, she loves to sing. She likes poetry. She likes art. And so you don't pick up things from just nowhere. It's always in the family line. And from what I hear here, Alex is also an artist. So we'll get to hear more about that maybe later. But for now, thank you so much, Tante Colette. Thank you very much, Manto, for making it happen.
Do you want Manto either now or later to share anything about Rejane?
Well, I just wanted to say that I can't sing, so I didn't get those genes.
But Manto, tell people about your first marriage proposal.
Well, I just wanted to say I miss you, Rejane. And, you know, we could have been married because way back when we were little kids, I was in a church with Kim and Rejane, and I told Kim that when we get older, I was going to marry her. And then Rejane heard that, and then she said, "What about me?" And I said, "Well, when I'm finished with Kim, I'll marry you." So it was very, very poignant moment. We spent a lot of time in our childhood together, but you know, as adults, you know, everybody's doing their own thing, but I've always kept up with her career. So really, really saddened, but really heartened by all of her accomplishments in the world. And I always brag about her because I have her album covers. So I always show people that I have a famous family, a very talented family. So.
Thank you, Manto. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Elle est formidable, elle chante en direct. Indeed!
Saved my life.
Last night a DJ saved my life, yeah. Cause I was sitting there bored to death, and then just one breath he said, you gotta get up, you gotta get up, you gotta get down, girl. You know you drive me crazy, baby. You got me turn into another man. Hold you on the phone, no one's home. Baby, why you leave me all alone? And if it wasn't for the music, I don't know what I'd do. Yeah. Last night a DJ saved my life. Last night a DJ saved my life for the broken heart.
Now we have some youth in the back. Could we introduce them? We have Mr. Sean, Sasha.
Excellent. But let me just make a couple of corrections, precisions rather. We did not mention that Mantovani Gay is a doctor. And yes, certainly Reggie's cousin, and I just learned almost wife, so that was great to know. Also, Joël Dussek spoke earlier. Joël is from the Domerson side of the family, and he's the one who mentioned 32 cousins. I hadn't done I hadn't calculated. Thank you, Joël, for sharing that information with us. And then, of course, you saw Tante Colette Gay. And Tante Colette is Mantovani Gay's mother. So Tante Colette is our aunt and the second eldest in the family. And to all the elders in the family, Tante Colette, Tante Bernini Pap, Tante Colette Gay, Tante Bernini Pap, Uncle Gérard Domerson in Haiti, to all of you, we say thank you for everything you've contributed to the family. Thanks a lot. All right, we can go on.
Joel, would you like to have a word?
Oh, hello, hello. So good to see everyone just being in the space. I just want to truly say that we are a very large community. And even when one person passes, it is a reckoning for us to remember to stay connected, to remember that we are truly connected in more ways than one, and that our talents, our gifts as family should consistently be shared. I know for so many of us, we may not have known the depths of how talented Rejan truly was in every intricacy that she did her and how she showed up in the world. But I just want to make sure that we just take a moment to just really sit with ourselves, sit with who she is and how she has made an impact, not just only in our family, but for the world. And so with that, just want to send my love as a cousin, as family to all of you, and merci un peu. Merci un peu.
Merci, Joël. Merci, Anpil. Hey, Sean. He's been waiting for a while. Sean is Rejan's grandchild and one of the sweetest nephew I have. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sean.
Hey.
Bonjour, Sean.
Hello. Bonjour. Je suis un peu stressé, donc j'ai écrit. I write it. What I have to say. And I'm gonna read it for you. I'm Sean. I'm Regent's first grandson. And I am here to share a life with you all and celebrate it. And I'm really glad we can share this moment together. It's good to know I am talking for I and Sasha Junior, her second grandson. We are happy and enjoyed every moment with our grandmother as we are happy and enjoyed every moment with Regine as our grandmother or as our mami bonbon. It was her nickname when we were children. We loved when she came at home in Brussels. She was fun, beautiful, and treated us as a grandmother treats her grandchildren. In 2012, she came for 2 weeks at my mother's house, and I enjoyed her presence. She sang every night for me because I was a big fan of Forbidden Opera, and in particular, her single L'Amour. She was sweet, and as she repeats me, I'm going to love you until lemons turn sweet, my precious Sean. I'll do the same for her. Voilà.
And you can also speak in French, Sean, because there are people who understand French. You could add whatever you want in French where you're, since he lives in Belgium. And so that's his first language.
OK. Donc, je vis en Belgique. J'ai 17 ans, bientôt 18. Et bah, je suis le petit-fils de Réjeanne. Elle a eu 3 autres petits-fils après du côté de son premier fils, Sacha. Donc, on ne l'a pas tous connu. Les 2 petits derniers l'ont moins bien connu. Mais je pense que s'ils l'ont déjà vu ou rencontré, ils auront un bon souvenir d'elle parce qu'elle était une bonne grand-mère malgré qu'elle soit très occupée. Donc, voilà. Et elle va nous manquer aussi.
Thank you, Sean, for that.
You're welcome. Thank you for being there for me. Thank you to hold the family, and I love you.
We love you.
We love you too.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. So we have one of the sons who can speak.
Sasha. We have Sasha available.
Vas-y, Sasha.
On m'entend?
Oui, on t'entend.
Hello, everyone.
Well,
I just want to say thank you to share this moment, and make me feel good to see that she was loved, and to see all those memories, those pictures, It's hard for me right now, but it feels good to know that there's family around us and give you all much love. Voilà. Okay.
Let's go ahead.
Oh, bisous à tout le monde.
Bisous à toi aussi, Sacha. Merci beaucoup.
Ah, de rien. Merci à vous.
Merci.
Are we going to have the third one before we move on? Mikael?
Yes, we'll have Mikael on. Here we go, Mikael.
Hello, hello, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
It's Mikael.
Hi. Thank you so much, everybody. I appreciate this moment dedicated to Mom. And yeah, it's beautiful that we connect all together. Share some memories, and yeah, she's with us, and she lives with us through memories of her. So this is, yeah, very meaningful to me. Thank you all for showing. Thank you all for coming.
Can you share one of your best memories of your mom?
There are so many.
I'm sure, just one.
You know, I just remember that when we were. I think Sasha was maybe 10 or maybe 4, something like that. And she asked me, oh, what would you want for your birthday? And I just said something ridiculous, thinking it couldn't happen, but she made it happen. She just, yeah, she had a way of making me believe that my heart's desires matters and making things happen. She was truly limitless.
Thank you. Yes. And that I could also say is a Don Vincent trait. Making impossible happen. All the Don Vincent women have this ability. So, but I think Rejan had even a higher dose than most of us. Thank you, Mikael, for sharing with us.
Okay, we'll go into another slide of Rejan.
Of a tree to my ancestors resting in peace, and still I rise. To my ancestors resting in peace, and still I rise. You cannot shake me, you cannot touch me, you cannot stop me, you cannot break me, you can't hold down a loose cannon, there's no obstacle, it's impossible. You cannot take me, you cannot shake me, you never stop me, you will not break me, I got a loose cannon inside of me and I know that nothing is impossible. To my ancestors resting in peace, and still I rise. To my ancestors resting in peace, and still I rise.
Beautiful piece. I hope we heard the song, the words. Very beautiful music. And I hope everyone catch on some of the words. You cannot break me. You cannot destroy me. No matter what. My ancestors rest in peace, and still I rise. That's Reggie. Yes, darling, you are rising. You will always continue to rise in our hearts, in our souls, in everything that we do that reminds us of you, that makes us know that we had this sister born in Congo, went around the world, make people happy. Thank you, Reggie. And continue to rise.
I'd like to add, Réjeanne was the one who spoke the least French in the family. Baïna was born in Haiti. I was born here, but at one point was sent to a boarding school in France where I learned French as my first language. And when we came to the States, it was because my parents had more children and it was banned. My mother did not want us to speak French at home because she did not want us to have an accent. And that was pretty common at that time. And so Réjeanne did not get that benefit. That's why it's so ironic that she ended up not only becoming an entertainer, but moving to Belgium and became proficient in French. And we used to, as kids, I remember my mother, you know how kids are, when my mother's on the phone, she would talk in French or Creole, and we would listen, and my mother would always joke, ah, these kids don't speak French, you know, that kind of dismissive attitude. But we got it. We understood, especially if it was good. You know, kids, they like when it's a good conversation, they figure it out. But to see her in school, she didn't like studying French. And yet, it was always amazing to see her in when I would visit Belgium and watch her speak and just the way she would carry herself. I said, you wouldn't know that was not her first language. So for all of us out there, you can learn anything if you put your heart to it.
Absolutely. No limit, except those you put on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Remember, you could still rise from wherever you are today. You could still rise. Actually, one tidbit is that each one of us are born in a different country. My mother is a woman who has no two children in the same place. We had a sister born in Liberia before Réjeanne. As she mentioned, is born in the United States. Réjeanne is born in Congo. Each one of us born in a different place. And I am IT, of course. So very different worldviews, very different positions about many, many things. But sisters, we are.
And to add to that, as we became adults, there was one time where literally the three of us were on planes traveling to another part of the world. So I think Baïna was traveling from Haiti to Los Angeles to translate. I forget where, I think Réjeanne was traveling from Europe to Latin America or South America. And maybe that was around the time when I was going to Japan. And my mother just couldn't believe that she had to worry about three daughters originating from three different cities or countries and traveling and hoping that everybody would land safely. But that's the one time I remember she said, this is a bit much to have to realize that my daughters are literally all over the world at this moment.
Well, she started it.
Yeah, she did.
She started the whole thing.
We have a brother Rudy or a sister Rudy?
Brother Rudy, cousin Rudy.
Cousin, okay. Backstage, let's invite him if he's willing to speak.
Hey guys, this is cousin Rudy. I don't know if you can see me.
Yes, we can. We can hear you too.
There we go. All right. That's better. Hey. Oh my gosh. What can I say? So I'm a musician as well. I love music. I've always loved music. And one thing I can remember about my cousin is when I used to listen to Last Night a DJ Saved My Life. When I used to listen to that song, oh my gosh, I remember dancing. I know, Kim, you got videos or pictures of me dancing somewhere in the family because I was a dancer and I'm still a dancer. And I just love my cousin's life, legacy, what she enjoyed doing. She lived her life to the fullest, to the best that she could. And she left us some music. She left us some love. She left us some cousins. So Mikael, Sasha, I love you guys. Please reach out to me. I'm on Facebook. I'm sure you guys can find me anywhere. I would love to connect with you. I have to travel one of these days to Europe to meet you guys. But I'm just so thankful for all of this. The picture looks amazing of Rejan. She definitely left us with some love. And I'm just glad to be part of this family. So love you guys. That's all I got.
So Rudy.
Yes.
Just sing a few notes of something.
I just sung Last Night a DJ Saved My Life. Okay, let me see. Some glad morning when this life is over, fly away to a place on God's election shore. Fly away. I love you, Ejan. God bless.
We love you, Rudy.
Thank you. I love you guys.
Thank you very much. And our next step.
Just checking to see if there's anyone back here.
Oh, I see Abbas is with us. Abbas is from Cameroon. He is participating from France. No, just saying hi. I see that he is with us. That's, we appreciate. Thank you very much. You see Paola is with us. Thank you, Paola. Gerda Nicola, how are you? Thank you to everyone on the call. Thank you very much to all those who are attending.
Smoking like a joint, you wanna puff it, cause we gonna rough it up like you never ever had it done to you before. Making a baseline run right through. Beware, because we coming out to you live. It's what you receiving. Your butt is ready, so we are achieving the motive to dance. We getting the boys, leaving out the romance. Put it with your posse in a buffalo stance. Releasing the juice that makes you feel dizzy. Now what you waiting for to get busy? Now it's a chance that you're taking while listening to the music we making. Over and on and on and on. Rock up to the beat, to the break of dawn. You gonna like it, boy, you gonna fight it. I'm on the MIC, so don't fight it.
Stumping and the jam is pumping. Look ahead, the crowd is jumping. Pump it up a little more, get the party going on the dance floor. See, cause that's where the party's at, and you find out if you do that. I want a place to stay. Get your booty on the floor tonight. Make my day. I want a
Kim, could you tell us about some facts about her music career?
Sure. I mean, first of all, people may not realize, because it's not necessarily true of many musicians, especially these days, but even 10, 20 years ago, it's a requirement in Haitian families, or at least a lot of Haitian families I was around, you had to learn how to play the piano. So we all played the piano. And then when she was on TV, we had to take singing lessons every Saturday. So an hour a week, depending on what was going on. And we would go to Manhattan, where we lived in Manhattan at the time, but we would go uptown and you would have your training. And that was a big part of what she did. It wasn't just, I can say she had quite a booming voice. And in fact, one of our other cousins, Marla Bello, said to me, "I remember your wedding." And she was singing without a mic in a big church. So she didn't need a mic to sing. But part of that is she trained. She was a trained performer, but a trained singer, first of all. And then she was the one that did not like the piano initially, but said in hindsight, she wished she had continued, because that would have helped her in her writing of music and other things. But that was okay. She did her thing. But in terms of her voice, she was gifted, but she also trained that gift. She wasn't just belting out a song just to belt it. And I wonder these days if there are singers who really put in that effort when they're not performing to do the work, to do the training, to work their craft, even if it's a gift, a God-given gift, you still need to work it. You still need to, you know, protect it. You still need to do things in reference to that. So yes, weekends, Saturday usually was blocked out for some type of class, training, whatever you want to call it. And in the other part, I'm trying to remember, I think it was the same summer she did Wilma, because we flew to Tennessee, but then I flew to New Mexico to my cousin's house for the rest of the summer, and Rejan stayed in New York. And I can't tell you, when I came back and had to go, we used to take a jazz class with Broadway actors, performers. And when we first arrived in that class, we thought we were good in Queens. We could only last the first 15 minutes. The rest of the 45 minutes, we could not keep up. And so the teacher said, "Well, if you come with me I'll give you 5 minutes or 10 minutes after the class to show you a move, and I want to see how fast you can catch up." And quickly, because we were motivated, partly because we were devastated that we thought we were, we realized we weren't that proficient. But that summer, she decided every day to do that dance class. It was amazing. It was, I felt like, you know that line, "What did I miss?" She was totally transformed as a dancer from, again, doing that for 2 months or 6 weeks every day as part of her summer that year. So
thank you, Kim. And yes, let me underline, Kim is telling us effort, training, discipline is what brings out the great art. It's effort, training, discipline, even if you have talents, even if you have God-given, to repeat Kim, God-given talent, effort, discipline, training, learning from those who know more is very important. But to that, I will add, Reggie is a passionate woman, born on 21st, and she takes everything that way with passion. She will love you with passion and hate you with passion. If you know how to dislike you, let's say. I don't think I've ever heard her say something about me, but she will have a very strong passionate reaction to things. And so when she takes something on, it's all of Rajan, not part of her. She doesn't dance with just her body. She dances with her soul. She dances with her heart. And then the body shows what's happening inside.
Dear God, are you there? Dear God, do you care? My vision's getting...
My name is Rajan Dominique Magloire. I come from Africa. I was born in Congo. But I was raised in New York City, and I've been living in Europe for the past many, many years. I did my first single called Last Night at DJ Saved My Life with a group called In Deep. And from then on, I just went out and toured a lot and worked with Technotronic and worked with Hit House and various groups that were doing dance music. My mom, she was the one who came up with the idea that I should start studying as many different styles of music as possible. And one of the styles that was very important to her, and she thought it would be very important to me technically, was classical music. I just basically used it to train my voice even until today. And finally, one day, I just realized, you know, it's ridiculous not to be able to incorporate that in the kind of music that I do, which is pop or hip hop or whatever, you know, I'm feeling for the moment. When I think about Forbidden Opera, I think about it as something which is not a new project that I'm doing. It's basically a combination of everything that I've been learning since I've been in this business. Starting as an actress, starting as a dancer, studying classical music, doing hip-hop, just a whole mesh mix-up of everything of who I am and putting it into one album. I perform on all the songs of the album, and I also produced it myself, which means I did the arrangements, did the programming, and also, you know, participated in the mixing. So I really wanted to do this all by myself because I wanted to make sure that, you know, my vision came through. And I wasn't so sure if somebody else, if I put it in their hands, they would be able to understand that. So I felt like for this baby, I had to do all of the work.
Beautiful, beautiful. She's clear. And you know, so many times we fail to capture the messages that our friends, families, our living are telling us. When you listen to each of those songs, this is Rajan's legacy. She wrote her will in this album. And as you take each song, you get to see another facet of her. My favorite song in this album is Africa, of course. And when she produced this song, she called me. That was probably the only call we had. No, that's not the only one. But that was one call from Belgium to Haiti. And we probably spent an hour. We both went broke because you pay, that time you paid both the receiver and the caller paid on the phone. So it was a very expensive call. But she only wanted to talk about this one song, Africa. That, that's the favorite. But all of them are good. Everything she's telling us about her. And that's why I felt it was necessary for us to have this moment and give Bijan her stage one more time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it that album really is an amalgamation of everything in her life. So if you hear more of that interview, you hear her say, even the title, Forbidden Opera. Why, you know, the whole concept of what is forbidden, for example, even in music or in life. And so, you know, she always liked to live on that edge in terms of, you know, how do we interpret it? You know, and it's not just a remix, as some people do now. They just take an old song and they add a little twist to it and they're trying to make it relevant, but a true, her perception, her view, her interpretation of classical music and its impact. So that album allowed her to really show what it can look like, what it can sound like, and it could be popular with youth or with anybody, but especially with youth that would say, well, I don't want to hear all these old or ancient songs, but she could bring them to life in a way that other people wouldn't have done it that way. And the challenge, you know, people can't realize when you are a musician or an actress, you're treated initially as, although you're perceived as the star, you're the bottom of the totem pole. The people making the money, the people controlling and all of those things, the record producers, all the other people, you can't imagine the power they have, that even though you think you're the artist, they still can wield their power over you. And so for her to finally get to the point where she could say, I'm gonna make this my own, I'm gonna learn how to write, to produce, to edit, to do all of that. And she said mainly because she didn't think anybody could do it the way she wanted it done. But that takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, energy. And really, a lot of people don't go that route, especially unless they are like Prince, who plays every instrument and who does certain things. And even he had trouble controlling his own music. So the ability to not only perform, but to control your music, which ends up being your life, is a big deal.
Yes, but it starts with a very clear vision. When you're very clear vision as to what you want to do, then that's when you will also see, well, you know, there's no one around me that can do it for me. I must do it myself. And to me, that's a key element, is that she reached a point which was clear. People wanted her to do this or that or the other, but she wanted to do this and she did that. Maybe we can have a chance to listen a little bit more about Alex's art.
Yes.
I got involved into art about 30 years ago. And I think my mom was pregnant of my first son. And in that process, I think I did the charcoal, and from there on, started to do watercolors. I bought a pad that had 12 pieces in there, 12 sheets, did all the 12 sheets. And then from there on, there was an opportunity to celebrate Black History Month. I had my first exhibit at the hospital, and somebody happened to tell me that, do you do acrylics? So I said, no, but then she gave me that suggestion. Next time I go to the art shop, I was going to go ahead and start to dive in acrylics. Started a few geometrical pieces. And then later I branched into the abstract form. And from there on, it has paid off. I mean, I have a tool shed full of art. And I do 2 exhibits a year at the Richmond Art Center. As a matter of fact, I just picked up my piece yesterday. And in the process of all that, also, I became an art collector. because if you are in the environment, there's a lot of things that you see, and being an artist, you find out that, you know, the potential artists, beginning starving artists, what they could do with their craft. I catch them early, and then from there on, I end up with a large collection. Then I fell in love with Asian art, and I met Prophet Dufault in Haiti, made a special trip trying to get thing from Haiti, but I met him. We kind of got together. He looked just like my uncle Armand, which is my grandmother's younger brother. And I had done a piece of work on fabric, a t-shirt, let him have it. He said he was going to sleep in it tonight in case, you know, he dies the next day or something like that. And from there on, I ended up with a large collection of Prophet Dufault and André Pierre, some of the real well-known Haitian artists. I thought I could just go there and buy art, but eventually ended up being a venture that will go ahead and enrich not only my collection, but also as a legacy for the, you got to protect art, got to protect, you know, the elders. These people came around one time, they may not be around, and people cannot duplicate them. So end up with a large collection of Prophet and André Pierre and a few other artists that Louis Zor, people that are internationally known, and this can be the legacy for the next generation. As a matter of fact, I'm thinking about maybe I need to donate it to a museum when I leave so that it could be protected, because my children are not into the art scene. So that's one thing that I want to cherish and pass it to the next generation, because I've enjoyed them. My job had 23 pieces of large pieces, such as 5 feet by 6 feet. They were there for 35 years. You know, remodeling of the job, I took them back home and put them in my storage. I also dabbed into music. I took 4 years of classical music. I had a teacher that was someone that I'd retired from Fisk University. He was the head of that department. She lives in Oakland. Ended up learning about German arias, French arias, and Italian arias, Portuguese arias, and had a chance to perform at special occasion among friends, and sometime also for special.
Excuse me, Brother Alex.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. Can I ask one question? Yeah. What message do you have for future generations of artists?
Number one, do not put limitations what you could do, because people are always concerned about what would so-and-so think. Don't worry about what people think. If you have, if it's in you and you feel the yearn to do it, pursue it. Start with the abstract form if you cannot draw a line or face or do that. Let your spirit actually guide your hand to do stuff. Number two, be passionate about it. Not only that, also, and be consistent at what you do. I do about like 21 pieces a year. And my wife told me, well, we're going to put all this, don't worry about it, honey. Eventually, we're going to find a place to put it. Art will find its own place in the community. Number three, learn about the business of art. That's very important, because people may not appreciate what you have. You may be gypped, and it is precious to you. And do not settle for less. You could do online. I have pieces that have been sold in Brazil, South Africa. Mexico has a large collection for my colleagues that were my classmates. Paris. Other places, not limit yourself to just one spot. And number three is that there's no limit in age also. Some folks, I started late. I was like 32 years old when I started. Some folks, you know, start early. I did doodle when I was younger, but that's not the quality. I didn't know what my calling was. But eventually, people ask themselves about, you know, what's my gift? It's in there. When you find it, polish it, and you eventually you'll get good at it. That's all I could say.
Thank you, Alex.
Yeah.
That's very insightful.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
One other thing I did to mention also, I ended up dabbing in poetry. There's 150 poetries that are in the scrub that I want to publish. I haven't gotten to that yet because my job is very busy. I mean, this is like an 8-hour job turned into a 10-hour job. And I do three things in my career. I'm an endocrinologist, I'm an internist, and I do my surgery. So
thank you, brother. Thank you, Alex.
To replace me when I leave the job. That's it.
Thank you, Alex. Is there anybody else who wants to comment? Well, Joelle, Mansorani?
I was going to say, since some people join later, I'd love for Sasha, Sean, or Michael to speak again because some people may have missed them the first time around.
Okay.
You guys are the prize. Her music is her legacy, but you are her legacy as well.
Okay. Michael, can you hear us? If you can, unmute.
Hello?
Yes, we can hear you. Yes, we hear you.
Perfect. Yeah. Thank you all for sharing. It's really heartwarming. And it was very interesting to hear about Forbidden Opera because that to me is more than just her album. That was like her message. If you listen to it and if you remember, she had also written a book about it. There was a book that also talks about the many queens she mentioned in her music. And yeah, just I'm grateful for it because I saw her making it and she had so much satisfaction. It was beautiful to see.
Michael, could you also share, because you had the benefit of performing on stage with your mom. What was that like? In fact, Quasi, can you put his picture to replace one of ours so we can see him? Because it's, thank you.
Yeah, that was such a joy, you know, when I was able to perform with my mom. It was like she was taking me to school. You know, so she would always bring up these stories about her life as a performer. Some of the stuff that you shared as well. I was like, okay, it's good to hear those stories and see how she would just turn it on, you know, when she's on stage, like the switch of a button and just go in mode. And then she had, you know, her little rituals. She liked to play she told me this. She liked to play LL Cool J's Mama Said Knock You Out. And yeah, that was just a trip. So when we were together, we were just like reminiscing about the time she performed and who she saw on stage and who she admired as well. So that was a good memory.
Plus, people wouldn't believe you were mother and son, I'm sure.
Yeah, of course, you know, but we would have fun with it, you know, we would just be ourselves and people would say, but who are they? What's the deal? What's going on?
Now, is it possible you could put a little more light on your face? Because, you know, there are relatives who still remember you as a little boy. They want to see your face.
Okay. Then I will go back inside.
Oh, right, you're now. Outside.
Maybe
okay.
Maybe there's someone who wants to come in between as well. Okay. And I go back indoors so I can use the lighting.
Okay.
Michael, could you tell us the name of the book?
Okay.
The name of the book, book was not published. So we'll have to publish it or create some version of it because it's stories, but a lot of pictures as well. It's like a it's got documents and stories mixed together. It's also some form of art.
Yeah. She had mentioned it to me at the time. She said it was going to be called Forbidden Opera as, you know, the album.
Thank you.
Yes, but definitely that could be a family project that we all put together, our voices, our talents, our skills, and put her book out.
That's a good idea.
And just so everyone knows, Mikael is outside in the dark as he is in China. So he's 12 hours later than we are.
Mm.
Well, 12 hours later than New York, I should say, the Eastern Standard Time.
Right.
So it's late for him, but we scheduled it this way. So everyone from the East Coast, Alex is in LA or California. So that's 3 hours the other direction. And Mikael is 12 hours east. So could we, once more, either Sasha or both, or Sean? No,
Kim, let's not go all out. Let's
okay.
We have Carol.
Carol Laos.
Let's see here.
Okay, let's try to stick back to our program. It's almost time.
Okay.
For us, we have, you know, let's not go away. I thank everyone who has participated. Certainly, if Sasha really, you know, has a short comment to share with, you know, Sasha, Michael is the second son, Sasha is the first son. We certainly won't stop them. And we will go on to carrying on with our program after that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sasha, do you have anything to say?
Yeah, I can say that. Well, I can tell already if my brother hears me because he's far away. I still got the book, so don't worry. it was nice listening to those songs. And yeah, everybody that knows her very well knows that every song was like was a part of her, was a. So yeah, y'all should go listen to it, and so like that you will still see her and feel her through her songs. And yeah, it was really nice touching with all y'all and seeing all the love. Et voilà.
Merci.
Merci.
Merci à vous.
Okay, we're coming to a close. Is there any final words?
Kim, you might want to go first.
Okay. I really appreciate everyone who's come to share this moment with us and to really get to see her whole life, not just the little snippets that people, because it's so true. Whenever people know that she sang Last Night a DJ Saves My Life, they never just say it. They always sing it to me. And then, or they're dancing just like Rudy did. It just becomes a whole, and it's different generations, but there's a definite reaction to that. So it's always so funny. But I wanted people to know the other parts of her, you know, the younger child that people didn't realize her first acting was actually she did a modeling job for Kodak and she was five. And the only reason she didn't do anything after that is my father thought, I don't know if I like this acting thing. And so it wasn't until he passed that my mother put us back into show business. So she started younger than most people thought, but she really blossomed, you know, as a preteen. And of course, when she went to Europe, she moved to Belgium with a contract from that song and never looked back. You know, she would visit, but for her, once she landed there, she made that her home. So I want, you know, I'm so glad people will get a clearer and a bigger, broader sense of who she was. As a person, as an artist, as a very passionate person, as a mother, so they could see the fullness of her life. Unfortunately, she passed young, but she accomplished more in that young life than many of us do in a lifetime.
Thank you. Yes, thank you, Kim. Well, first of all, I want to say thank you to every member of the family who has joined this program. I want to say thank you to those who participated and as well as those who just followed through the various medium. Sous toi la rien, en tant qu'Haïtien, c'est toi la rien, m'connais. That's what we call the web, toi la rien. So all those of you who are on the toi la rien, we thank you. All those who've sent comments, we thank you. All those who participated, special thank you to Gerda. Gerda and I, on March 21st, we shared a bottle of champagne because we know us, my sister loved the bubbly. In fact, we're the three of us, Kim, Gerda, and I. We, you know, even though we were in the same place, but each one had a bottle. And even though some of us don't drink, but, you know, this was part of what we were doing for her. It wasn't about us, it was about her. So we say thank you to all of you, to the volunteers we see, to people in IT who are having a hard time with electricity and internet, who keep popping in and out, and we really appreciate all your effort. To our friends in France, we've noticed, in England, all of the people, the volunteers of Fondation Félicité who have joined us, thank you very, very much. Most of all, thank you to the elders of the family. Tante Bernini Pap, Tante Colette Gay, Uncle Gérard Domerson. These are the elders in our family that we know of, because sometimes we do find out, I had at one point discover a 120-year-old man, a cousin of my great-grandfather. So of those we know, these are the elders. And we thank them for their permission to allow us to do this program and their participation. Thank you very much to everyone. And I'm very serious about carrying on with the legacy. Taking what Rishan has as unfinished objective and finish it. As a matter of fact, this is a principle. People who become after someone else, if you become director, general director, or president, the first thing you should do is accomplish an unfinished objective of the one who has left the position. And then you set your objectives to carry on in the continuum. So, Sasha, Mikael, Sean, Sasha Junior, everyone, thank you, thank you, thank you. And to our unborn children who will come and will follow in the footsteps of all the talents, the skills, the passion, the love there is in this family, we welcome you already. In Rejan's name, thank you to everyone.
Right by your side, don't be afraid, just close your eyes. My spirit is near, but it's lost in time. We're in two different worlds. But I'll get to you in this lifetime.
I know. I know all these things. Is it done?
Yes.